Today here at St. James. Just a couple of things as we get started. There is in your pew rack in front of you what we call a connect card. And if you want to keep up with what's going on at St. James, what that means is you'll receive our church email. We send out usually twice a week. If you put your name and your email address on there, put it in offering plate, we'll put you on the list. If you don't do email, if you put your mobile phone number, then when I send out the email, I'll just text you to your phone a link and you can read it just like everybody else. There is also in your pew rack an I Gave Online card. If you give online, then when the offering plate comes by, put that card in as your act of worship. If you want to give online, then there's a website or a QR code. You can use either one of those and that works really easily. Toward the end of the service, we'll have communion. Will come up and receive communion. If coming up for communion, if you're not comfortable being around that many people, then if you want to grab one of the single serve communion cups from the entryway and keep it with you at your seat, I'll give you instructions on how to use that in a moment. And then when there are readings on the screen, the white text, the leader reads that, the yellow text, we all read together. Well, welcome. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today. This is a Sunday in the church that's often called Reformation Sunday. We remember the Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, and the truths that came back to the surface and that we hold dear in our faith. But let's take the time during the prelude now to center ourselves and to focus ourselves for worship.
Paper or watch the TV news.
God, it seems we live in a world of chaos.
Our social media feeds are full of conflict and disaster.
Will we ever hear good news?
God, in the midst of the turmoil and chaos, we declare our trust in you to be our refuge.
Amen.
And now let's remain standing for our hymn. We're going to sing This Is My Father's World. We finish, not this week, but next week, our study on Amazing Grace, the 250th year of the hymn. Next week's All Saints Day, and we'll talk about that last verse when we've been there 10,000 years. This week we talk about a verse that oftentimes is not included in hymnals. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, about cataclysmic and tumultuous events, and that seems like our world today. So we're going to talk about that in a few minutes, and we're going to sing that verse after the message. But this morning, this is my Father's world. There's a verse that says that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. And that's our theme for today. Let's sing this together.
This is my
Go ahead and have a seat. We come to the time in the service we call our prayer of confession. And it's a time of maybe moving a little bit farther in, a little bit closer to God to receive what God has for us today. And here's what I want you to do this morning. Think about this. God, when I think about the confusion and upheaval and unrest in our world, I feel... Take a moment in silent prayer. Tell God how you feel. Worried, afraid, angry, apprehensive. Talk to God. When I think about the confusion and upheaval and unrest in our world, I feel. Talk to God about that this morning. Then two unison prayers of confession. Pray this with me. God, forgive me for when I have failed to be touched by the suffering of others. In this one, let's pray together. God, forgive me for letting fear or worry consume me when I can trust you. God promises that when we confess our sins, God is faithful to forgive us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus, we all are forgiven. And as God's forgiven people, we're going to take this time to bless each other with God's peace. We call it the passing of the peace. We're going to do a fist bump today. Peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Just greet one another. You know, it's actually, as I greet people like that, I'm actually praying for them. Peace of Christ be with you. That's my prayer for you. And peace of Christ be with you. They're praying for me. So let's stand together and greet one another with God's peace. And there'll be a couple of discussion questions afterward. Find some people to talk to. Peace of Christ be with you, Trish. Peace of Christ be with you. So here is our first question to think about here. Just a cheery thought for you this morning. Something positive to get your day going. What world problem worries you the most? Just keeping it light, right? What world problem worries you the most? Talk about that just for a minute. Okay, next question. What is one thing you do or could do to make the world a better place? What is one thing that you do or could do to make the world a better place? Now, we're not talking about Mother Teresa Nobel Peace Prize. It could be something small you do. But what's one thing you do or you could do to make the world a better place? Talk about that for a minute. Thank you. Go ahead and find your places. Have a seat. Have a seat, and we'll sing our gathering song together. Jesus, name above all names.
Our new members come up here to join, and
And we make promises to them, and they make promises to us as their church. I want you to remember that that is your village too. Not just because these grown-ups love you all unconditionally when you have been hit, when you come in a little late and tired, right? When you might miss church for a cross-country week, that's okay. We love you and we cheer you on. But the gift that we as young people bring to the grown-ups is joy. What else? What are our tools we bring to the village? What do you think we can give to these grown-ups? Yeah, joy and love and silliness. Your masters of silly, right? And a faith that is so pure. So let's say a prayer today of thanksgiving that we are all part of this village together and we can promise to love and take care of one another. Are you ready to pray? Should we make a village prayer? Let's make a village. All right, grown-ups can make a village with their friends too. God, you have given us this church to love and be loved in your world. God, as children, let us give out our joy and our laughter. Let us heal our village with giggles and with faith, with books and toys and games and fun and belonging. And God, when we're grown-ups, help us to recognize the importance and significance of each child in our village. Help us work to make it your world for them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. It's time for our scripture now. Psalm 46 is our reading for today. The scripture is in your bulletin. So if you want to follow along as Judy reads, feel free to do that.
This is Psalm 46, and I think it's very appropriate for this period in our lives. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, the waters roar and foam, but though the mountains tremble with tumult, Selah. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. Nations are in an uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice. The earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. This is the word of God for all of the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. You see that there is not only our text, but there's some questions there. And we're going to talk about those in a few minutes. But first, I want to kind of walk you through just a couple of ideas about the psalm. A lot of you are familiar with the fact that the psalms are songs. They are poetic. It's the hymnal of the Old Testament Hebrew Christians. And you see a lot of poetic devices or parts to this psalm. For example, up at the top, right underneath, and it's in your worship bulletin, right underneath Psalm 46, that you have what's called the superscription. Remember, I talked to you about this last week, that the superscription, the part in little italics print right under the number, now not a heading, a themed heading that an editor would give, but this superscription, this is actually in the Hebrew text. So if you get a Hebrew Bible out, it's verse 1 in Psalm 46. And here's what it says. It says, to the leader, like the choir leader, the choir director, the worship leader, of the Korahites. The sons of Korah were musicians and worship leaders in temple worship in ancient Israel. According to Alamoth, some interpreters think that Alamoth means like, this song is for the sopranos. This is for the high voices. And it says a song. Then you notice, also verses 7 and 11 are the same. If this song, like many songs, even in our day, has a refrain, a chorus. And verse 7 is the refrain. And then you got another verse, and then verse 11 is the refrain. I put those in blue there for you so you could pick those out. And you notice verse 1. I've got it in bold. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. That's kind of like you learn in English to have a topic sentence for your paragraph. That's like the summary. That's like a summary, an introductory truth. But then you go down to verse 11, and he uses the refrain there and kind of sums it up and says, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. So this song has both an opening summary statement and a closing conclusion summary statement. And then you notice the use of the word Selah. And I think I put that in green there. That word Selah, it's not translated. It means like to pause. In music, it might be like a rest in the music. It means to stop and think. Maybe if they were performing this song in temple worship, they would have had an instrumental interlude there for you to think about the verse that went right before. Maybe that's what they would do. So this is poetry. Now, one thing that's kind of interesting, Psalm 46, and then you can, if you have time and you want, you can look at the Bibles in your pews, or you can look at your Bible when you get home. Psalm 46, Psalm 48, and Psalm 71 are often interpreted as being psalms of rejoicing over God saving Jerusalem from the destruction by the Assyrians in 701 BC. In 701 BC, the Assyrians invaded Israel and they destroyed every fortified city except Jerusalem. And that's why, you know, when it says, oh, God is in the city, God won't let the city be touched. And so a lot of interpreters say these psalms are rejoicing over God saving Jerusalem. The only problem with that is that doesn't explain why they're still in the Psalter, while they're still in the Psalms. Because in 586, the Babylonians captured every city, including Jerusalem, and they burned Jerusalem down. And so why would the song leaders leave a song about God saves Jerusalem always? Commentators say the reason it's still in the Psalms is because the historical occasion of the writing might have been the saving of Jerusalem in 701 BC. But God's not finished yet. There's still a broader, farther prophetic implication of this psalm, that God is still at work in the world, that God's not finished with our world yet. And 701, 586, 2023, whatever, God is still working. And so that's why this psalm, even though maybe it's talking about a historical situation, that's why it's still in the Psalms, because it reflects God's acting in our world. Now, here's what I want you to do real quickly. You have some questions. And if you want to pull a pen out or the pencil from the pew rack in front of you, I'm going to put a little bit of music on. I'm going to let you take just a few minutes. There are three questions. The fourth question, what does it mean that God is our refuge? Skip that one for now. But the first three questions, what does this psalm tell us about the world we live in? What does this psalm tell us about God? What does this psalm tell us about ourselves? Read through it, make some notes, try to answer that question. What does this psalm tell us about the world we live in? What does it tell us about God? What does it tell us about ourselves? Take just a minute and work on that, and we'll talk about it in a moment. Don't worry about it being deep. Don't worry about it being right. Just your brainstorming. You will not be graded. So, let's talk about what we saw. What does this psalm tell us about the world we live in? Just based on this text, what do you think? Anybody got any thoughts?
Turmoil.
Seems to be an echo in here. Yeah,
it exists.
And the world exists, and turmoil exists in our world, yes. Anything else you see about our world in this psalm? What's that? Hatred? Okay, yes, there are some phrases here that seem to sound kind of angry, that people are angry. Yeah. Okay, anything else?
It
It changes? Okay, yes, definitely. There will be natural disasters. There will be political upheaval. There will be, and I got this word right there, turmoil and uncertainty about the direction human history is taking. Kind of sums up where we're heading, where we're sitting today, maybe even. What does this psalm tell us about God? What truths do we see about God in this psalm?
He's always with us.
Always with us? Okay. In all situations, God's with us. Okay? Anything else you see about God?
He's in charge, no one else.
I like that part, no one else. Yeah. Bethany?
Stay on the good side.
I'm sorry, I'm missing that. I think that's good advice. Anything else about God? Shelley?
Yes, it's sort of along the lines of that God is in charge, but God also wants us to recognize that God is in charge.
Okay, yeah. I think that's an important piece to it. Yes, very much so. Okay, now, I found this third question a little more, maybe there was less information in the psalm. What does this psalm tell us about ourselves? What have we got there?
Don't panic.
Don't panic. That's easy for you to say. Maybe not. Okay, don't panic. That's good. Anything else? What does this psalm tell us about ourselves?
Turn to God when you're
angry. Turn to God when you're angry. Yes. Anything else you say? Yeah.
We're a mess.
We're a mess. Yeah. I think so. Yes. Okay, anything? Yeah, Dan?
I am weak, but he is strong. Amen.
Amen. That's kind of where this whole thing's going. That's right. Good. Okay. Yeah, yes, ma'am.
We are looking at the end, and I'm anxious to look forward to that wonderful.
Yeah. And we don't necessarily see how things are going to turn out now. Yes, that's good. That's good. Yes, be encouraged, yes. I put down our refuge is in God. I like that the beginning of the psalm, it says, we will not fear. I put in parentheses, well, I might, but. And then God is with us. Now, that last question, what does it mean? It says in the psalm that God is our refuge. It's just a statement, a fact, just a broad statement. God is our refuge. What do you think that means? How does that work out? What do you think it means that God is our refuge? I'm sorry.
Turn to God.
Okay. Anything else, Doug?
Whatever happens, we're His.
Amen. We're His. Yes.
Got our back.
Yeah, got our back. Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Kind of like Romans 8:28. That's good. Shelley?
Well, it must be like, I feel like it's a very violent event for the violence.
Okay.
And it's not like God being just like stop fighting.
Broke
them down, shattered the spear, burned the shield. It just seems like it's a violent event.
Okay. Yeah. And definitely, it's kind of like God puts his foot down. Yeah, kind of like Okay. God is our refuge. It means that God is with us and will take care of us. It means that no one else or nothing else is our refuge. Security comes from nowhere else. Not from how much money you got in the bank, not from your bunker you got built in the basement, not from any. Security comes from God. Think about all that you have been through in your life. Maybe some of it you wondered if you would make it through, but you were still here. You did make it through. God was with you in trouble. Seems no matter how much we make it through, though, No matter how many times God is with us in trouble, we don't learn. We still fear. We still worry. I think the assurance here is not that we will not have trouble, because Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. But that the trouble we have will not be permanent, will not be lasting. God can redeem it. God can heal our hurts. And our eternal souls cannot be touched. And that's kind of what Martin Luther was saying in the Reformation. That this trouble cannot separate us from God. Quite often, God does not bring us out of trouble. God brings us through the trouble. A couple of things about this psalm. It says that twice in the refrain there, it talks about the Lord of hosts. That does not mean like God's giving a dinner party, hosts. That word hosts is like mighty armies. That's what that means. So in other words, God is powerful. That's the God who is our refuge. So it's saying that God is mighty. God is powerful. So God can be our refuge. Also, I like, do you see that last part of the refrain? The God of Jacob is our refuge. What struck me about that is he doesn't say the God of Abraham. Doesn't say the God of Moses. He doesn't even say the God of Israel. See, Jacob, his name was changed to Israel. But it doesn't say the God of Israel. It says the God of Jacob. Jacob, the deceiver. Jacob, the one that cheated his brother. Jacob, the one that had to run for his life from his brother who wanted to kill him. Jacob, who cheated everybody he ever met until he wrestled with that angel. And God changed him. And he changed his name to Israel, Prince with God. The God of Jacob. Maybe we can see ourselves a little more in Jacob. And when we think about the song Amazing Grace, that's the story of Jacob. And so the Lord of hosts is with us, mighty God. The God of Jacob, a God of grace, a God of amazing grace is our refuge. Down at the very bottom of your worship bulletin, after the questions, God is bigger than my problem, and God cares about me and my situation. I may be afraid, but God will bring me through. Freedom from fear and worry is probably going to be temporary, intermittent at best. We're going to slip back into fear. That's probably the default position for human nature. And we're going to have to remind ourselves, or be reminded, that God is with us. That's maybe one of the reasons we gather on Sunday mornings, to be reminded. The story is not over. The last chapter has not been written. How things are is not how things will be. And that's what we hold on to in turbulent, tumultuous, chaotic times. I've got a couple of books that I really like. They're both psalms for kids. And this one's called Psalms for Young Children. And here's how it translates Psalm 46. It just kind of summarizes it. If the ground starts to shake, if the mountains break into pieces and fall in the sea, if the waves grow as big as giants, I'm not scared. God is with me. God provides a safe place for me to hide. That's Psalm 46. And this other one, I recently got this one. This one's called Psalms of Wonder. And boy, I love this book. In fact, I like it so much. And let me see, page 21. Okay, page 21. Here it is. And this is a beautiful image there. It says this: God is our shelter and strength whenever trouble is near. And because God is close to us, we will not fear. Let mountaintops drown in the sea, and let the sea roar. The city of our God still laughs because God lives in her. God will not let her be moved. God comes at dawn to bring her help. People rage and kingdoms fall, but when God speaks, the whole world melts. God is with us. Look at everything that God has done. God ends war across the earth, splits the spear, and breaks the bow. God says, be still. Know I am God. We sing because we know God is with us and is our shelter everywhere we go. This is a suggestion that Christine gave me. I thought it was a good idea. That rendition of Psalm 46 from Psalms of Wonder, I put it on a little card like this. And when you come up for communion, there's some on each end of each row. Pick it up, take it with you, put it somewhere where you can see it, to pray it, to remind yourself that God is with us. Maybe after you watch the news, you get this out and say, oh, okay, blood pressure can go down some now. The story is not over. The last chapter has not been written. How things are is not how things will always be. We're going to sing now. We're going to sing a song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Takes the verses of Amazing Grace, puts a chorus with them about our forgiveness in Christ. And the verse that we're looking at today, the earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, cataclysmic, chaotic, tumultuous turmoil. But the verse says, but God, who brought me here, beloved, God, he will be forever mine. God is forever. I am his and he is mine. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you.
seated. Thank you. All right. Well, we come to the time in our service when we're going to receive some new members today. And so let's see here. Move this back here. Excellent. Okay. So, and this is, of course, a kind of a, it might be a surprise to some of you, but we are running a little bit behind here. All right, here we go. All right, let me see if I can get, there we go. Excellent. All right, good. So, those who are joining today, come on up, if you would, please. Come on up. There we go. And stand over here. Come right on up. Stand over on this side. Let's keep coming. Just make a crowd over there. You're going to want to be able to see a screen because, you know, you want to know what you're signing your life away to, right? Let me tell you who we got here. So this is over here. This is the Smith family. Mark, Shelley, Simone. The ones who weren't going to claim the rest of them. Langston and Marie. I wouldn't have picked those two. Sandy and Rick. Diane, the mystery lady whose name tag's turned around. But that's okay. to see if I could remember. That's good. That is good. That's why we have these name tags, because generally I don't. And Larry, who I've known for about 100 years. So I wouldn't forget Larry's name. Joining the United Methodist Church, here's how we do it. There are what we call membership vows. And it's not like getting married, but it is. I don't know. Maybe. But because you do say I do. But here we go. So, by the way, to be considered for membership, you need to be a baptized person. If you have not been baptized, we baptize you. But Richard, I was baptized as a child. Well, good. A lot of these people were. And United Methodists, if you were baptized in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit, if you were baptized with Trinitarian baptism, we receive that baptism. I was baptized in the Baptist Church. Good. Lutheran Church. Good. Presbyterian Church. Good. It's Trinitarian baptism. So, here we go. Do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin?
I do.
Okay, this is for them, but if y'all want to answer, you can. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Okay. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your trust, your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which God has opened, which Christ has opened to people of all
nations and races?
I do.
As members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries?
I will.
As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayer, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Now, the pastor addresses the congregation. Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these members now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ.
We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness,
that they may grow in their trust with God and be found faithful in their service to others.
We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk on the way that leads to life. Let's pray. God, we ask that you pour out your blessings on these folks as they become officially part of our church family. Lord, we pray you would help us all to work together to serve you and to build each other up.
We pray this in your name. Amen. Amen.
So we welcome you as official members of St. James United Methodist Church. Special prayer practice we were going to do for our prayer time, but we're just out of time. So, and we still have communion and offering left. We were going to pray for the world, and we had notes we were going to write. And if you guys wanted to do that during communion, write a prayer or an affirmation of hope, bring it down and put it on the globe, you can. But we're going to cut to the chase, as they say. So our prayer time today, now we joys and concerns, we're going to pray for Trish's brother. His name is Brian Whitlock, and Brian is on the list for liver transplant.
He's going to see if he
qualifies. Okay. Brian is going to see if he qualifies to be on the list. So that's the first step right there. So we want to be in prayer that Brian would qualify for that. Anybody else have any? Yes, Judy? Okay, so Jan Schoberg is still in Florida, and so cancer stage 4, and she's not doing well. Jan was a member here before she moved for a long time. She was our financial secretary for many years, and a lot of you know Jan. She's just a real sweet lady. Anybody else have anything you want to? Yeah, Terry? Yeah. You're feeling good enough to go places, but not 100%.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Let's be in prayer for Bob. Yeah, Anita? I'm sorry, who was that? Okay. Yes, let's be in prayer. And his name is Kenny. I almost said Danny, but I knew that wasn't. It was close. Okay. Let's pray for Kenny. All right, let's bow for prayer. God, we bring these cares and concerns before you, God, for Jan, for Bob, for Kenny, for Brian. Lord, we ask that you hold them in your love and care, surround them with your peace. God, our prayer is for relief from pain and suffering and for healing, God. God, we leave them in your care. God, help us as we walk the course you've got before us in this world, that we would walk it in faith with you as our refuge. Not to be discouraged or afraid because of the things we see around us, but God, give us the courage to trust in you. And let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Time for Holy Communion. I guess we just take this off since the battery's dead. I don't worry about it. Okay. And I just changed the batteries right before the service, so there you go. Let's begin. God's presence is with us.
The Spirit is among us and in us.
Let us center our attention on God.
We open our lives to receive God's grace.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
And we're going to do that, giving of our thanks and praise in song this morning. And we're going to sing, Eat This Bread. Let's sing this together. Scriptures tell us on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, eat this and remember me. Then after the meal he took the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this and remember me. Let's pray together. God, we ask that you pour out your Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. May they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be your body serving you in this world. The bread we break is the bread of life. The cup we share is the cup of salvation. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. So if I could have my servers come up, please. If you're using one of the single serve cups, you just pull back the first layer, eat the wafer, body of Christ given for you. You pull back the second layer, drink the cup, blood of Christ shed for you. You're invited to come to the Lord's table. You'll just come down the center aisle, go to either side. You'll receive a small piece of bread, eat that, small cup of juice, drink that, and then return by the side aisles. And if you want to pick up one of the Psalm 46 prayer cards there at the end of each aisle, take one with you. Need gluten-free, you can see me and I can help you with that. Thank you all. It's time for our offering now, so if I could have our ushers come on down. And we'll take our offering. You're welcome. She worries she's going to step on you with her boots. Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much for the gifts you so graciously and generously give us. So as we give back to you a portion of what you've given us, we pray you put your blessing on these gifts to do your work in this world. We pray this in your name. Amen. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Be seated, please, just for a moment. We are having, looks like Christine's already gone to get it, make the final preparations. Out the table room door to the right, under the big pine tree, pie. And I have seen some of these pies, and they look amazing. Talk about amazing grace, right? This is amazing pie. And so it's in honor of our new members we're receiving. Make sure you say welcome and hello to them and have some pie right out the door on the right. Look, loneliness and isolation is an epidemic. One of the cures for that is a church community. Well, I just want to go home. I don't want to talk to anybody. You need to. You need to. Let's spend time together. Let's get to know each other. Let's talk to each other. So I invite you, I encourage you, I enjoin you to go eat some pie. Well, I was trying to watch what I eat, but the pastor told me I had to eat pie. I'll take the hit for you. You go right ahead. But we're so glad that you're with us today. We're so glad for our new members. If you didn't pick up one of the Psalm 46 prayer cards, they're still here. You can pick one up on either side. So today, as we go out, we remember that the Lord of hosts is with us. God is mighty. And the God of Jacob, a God of amazing grace, is our refuge. And all God's people said, Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us. Go eat some pie.